church from the Hagens.
I'm John, and since the 1st of March, I've been on annual leave as my company has been really struggling. And I'm only going into the office once a month to do the monthly pay run. I've also, in the lockdown period, I've been trying to support local business by frequenting the coffee club, buying daily coffees and takeaway meals, and they've really appreciated the support. Also, I've done a few crosswords and I've read 3 books, which is amazing for me because I only normally read on long haul flights. Well, the other thing is this week we've started our life group back, meeting face to face, and that's really exciting. I'm really pleased about that.
I'm Mari and I'm retired, so I've enjoyed this time of quietness and slowness. And I've continued my usual things like walking our dog Hannah here, and Zoom meetings has been the new thing for me. I've got our life groups onto Zoom, and also I'm one of the playgroup leaders, and we've been having weekly Zoom meetings with the playgroup mums, which has been really good because we've kept in contact with them during this time. Bye.
Bye.
Well, welcome everyone to church at Sydenham Baptist this morning in our different forum to what we are normally used to. But it's great to be with you all. Can't see you, but we're going to be with you together as we worship now in a song called The Lion and the Lamb. So let's join together in worship.
He's coming on the clouds, kings and kingdoms will bow. Every chain will break as broken hearts declare His praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee. Who can stop the Lord? stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before Him.
Well, I hope you enjoyed worshipping along with us just then in the song Lion and the Lamb. I'm going to read a scripture verse for you from 1 Peter 4:10. God has given each of you a gift from His great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to serve one another. And I think at this time, the gifts that are being used are still being used. Our pastors are still ministering and using their gifts. Our church council are using their gifts. Our ministry team leaders are using their gifts. Everyone is still using their gifts to keep the church functioning. As we come to a time of prayer and offering, let's consider how we can use our gifts, be they financial or whatever, at this time to keep the church functioning, to keep communication going, to keep honouring and loving each other in this time. So let's now come to a time of prayer. We pray for our congregation, Lord, be it distant, be it separated from each other physically, but in spirit we can be joined together. We can be one with each other in spirit because we are connected through You. We pray for our pastors as they continue to minister to people, as they continue to bless You and serve You and do the work of the church. There is things to be done, and I'm thankful for the fact that they are doing. I'm thankful for some of them resuming face-to-face contact. I pray for all the life group leaders as they may be morphing into that at this time. I pray too for the counsellors, they continue to search for a senior pastor for our church. Lord, that You would guide, You would lead, You would bring about Your will in this place, in Your time, Lord. We pray, Lord, that as we transition out of restrictions a bit more and a bit more, that You would be with each one of us. Lord, as we continue to think about this time, we pray for Your protection. We pray for health and strength for each one of us. We pray that You will be close to us, near to us, that we would know Your peace at this time. And Lord, we pray as we now give our offerings that we are continuing to support the work of our church, united together in a different forum, but still united in purpose to bring about the glory of God on this earth. And this we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. These events happened in the days of King Xerxes, who reigned over 127 provinces, stretching from India to Ethiopia. At that time, Xerxes ruled his empire from his royal throne at the fortress of Susa. In the third year of his reign, he gave a banquet for all his nobles and officials. He invited all the military officers of Persia and Media, as well as the princes and nobles of the provinces. The celebration lasted 180 days, a tremendous display of the opulent wealth of his empire and the pomp and splendour of his majesty. When it was all over, the king gave a banquet for all the people, from the greatest to the least, who were in the fortress of Susa. It lasted for 7 days and was held in the courtyard of the palace garden. The courtyard was beautifully decorated with white cotton curtains and blue hangings, which were fastened with white linen cords and purple ribbons to silver rings embedded in marble pillars. Gold and silver couches stood on a mosaic pavement of porphyry, marble, mother of pearl, and other costly stones. Drinks were served in gold goblets of many designs, and there was abundance of royal wine, reflecting the king's generosity. By edict of the king, no limits were placed on the drinking, for the king had instructed all his palace officials to serve each man as much as he wanted. At the same time, Queen Vashti gave a banquet for the women in the royal palace of King Xerxes. On the seventh day of the feast, when King Xerxes was in high spirits because of the wine, he told the seven eunuchs who attended him, Mehuman, Biztha, Harbona, Bigtha, Abigatha, Zetha, and Carcass, to bring Queen Vashti to him with the royal crown on her head. He wanted the nobles and all the other men to gaze on her beauty, for she was a very beautiful woman. But when they conveyed the king's orders to Queen Vashti, she refused to come. And this made the king furious, and he burned with anger. He immediately consulted with his wise advisers, who knew all the Persian laws and customs, for he always asked their advice. The names of these men were Karshina, Shestha, Admatha, Tarshish, Meredes, Marcena, and Mecumen, seven nobles of Persian and Media. They met with the king regularly and held the highest positions in the empire. "What must be done to Queen Vashti?" the king demanded. "What penalty does the Lord provide for a queen who refuses to obey the king's orders, properly sent through his eunuchs?" Mecumen answered the king and his nobles, "Queen Vashti has not only wronged the king, but also every noble and citizen throughout your empire. Women everywhere will begin to despise their husbands when they learn that Queen Vashti has refused to appear before the king. Before this day is out, the wives of all the king's nobles throughout Persia and Media will hear what the queen did and will start treating their husbands the same way. There will be no end to their contempt and anger. So to please the king, we suggest that you issue a written decree, a law of the Persians and Medes that cannot be revoked. It should order that Queen Vashti be forever banished from the presence of King Xerxes, and the king should choose another queen more worthy than she. When this decree is published throughout the king's vast empire, husbands everywhere, whatever their rank, will receive proper respect from their wives." The king and his nobles thought this made good sense, so he followed Mecumen's counsel. He sent letters to all parts of the empire, to each province, in its own script and language, proclaiming that every man should be the ruler of his own home and should say whatever he pleases. Chapter 2. But after Xerxes' anger had subsided, he began thinking about Vashti and what she'd done and the decree he had made. So his personal attendant suggested, "Let us search the empire to find beautiful young virgins for the king. Let the king appoint agents in each province to bring these beautiful young women into the royal harem at the fortress of Susa. Hegai, the king's eunuch in charge of the harem, will see that they are all given beauty treatments. After that, the young woman who most pleases the king will be made queen instead of Vashti." This advice was very appealing to the king, so he put the plan into effect. At that time, there was a Jewish man in the fortress of Susa whose name was Mordecai, son of Jair. He was from the tribe of Benjamin and was a descendant of Kish and Shimei. His family had been among those who King Jehoiachin of Judah had been exiled from Jerusalem to Babylon by King Nebuchadnezzar. This man had a very beautiful and lovely young cousin, Hadassah, who was also called Esther. When her father and mother died, Mordecai adopted her into his family and raised her as his own daughter. As a result of the decree, Esther, along with many other young women, were brought into the king's harem at the fortress of Susa and placed into Haggai's care. Haggai was very impressed with Esther and treated her kindly. He quickly ordered a special menu for her and provided her with beauty treatments. He also assigned her 7 maids specially chosen from the king's palace, and he moved her and her maids into the best place in the harem. Esther had not told anyone of her nationality and family background because Mordecai had directed her not to do so. Every day, Mordecai would take a walk near the courtyard of the harem to find out about Esther and what was happening to her. Before each young woman was taken to the king's bed, she was given the prescribed 12 months of beauty treatment, 6 months of oil of myrrh, followed by 6 months with special perfumes and ointments. When it was time for her to go to the king's palace, she was given her choice of whatever clothing or jewellery she wanted to take from the harem. That evening, she was taken to the king's private rooms, and the next morning she was brought to the second harem, where the king's wives lived. There she would be under the care of Shazgar, the king's eunuch, in charge of the concubines. She would never go to the king again unless he had especially enjoyed her and requested her by name. Esther was the daughter of Abihail, who was Mordecai's uncle. Mordecai had adopted his younger cousin Esther. When it was Esther's turn to go to the king, she accepted the advice of Haggai, the eunuch in charge of the harem. She asked for nothing except what he suggested, and she was admired by everyone who saw her. Esther was taken to King Xerxes at the royal palace in the early winter of the 7th year of his reign, and the king loved Esther more than any of the other young women. He was so delighted with her that he set the royal crown on her head and declared her queen instead of Vashti. To celebrate the occasion, he gave a great banquet in Esther's honour for all his nobles and officials, declaring a public holiday for the provinces and giving generous gifts to everyone. Even after all the young women had been transferred to the second harem and Mordecai had become a palace official, Esther continued to keep her family background and her nationality a secret. She was still following Mordecai's directions, just as she did when she lived in his home. One day, as Mordecai was on duty at the king's gate, 2 of the king's eunuchs, Bigthana and Teresh, who were guards at the door of the king's private quarters, became angry at King Xerxes and plotted to assassinate him. But Mordecai heard about the plot and gave the information to Queen Esther. She then told the king about it and gave Mordecai credit for the report. When an investigation was made and Mordecai's story was found to be true, the 2 men were impaled on a sharpened pole. This was all recorded in the book of the history of King Xerxes' reign. May God bless the reading of his word.
Welcome again to church. It's great to have you with us. This week we start a new series, which I'm really excited about. It's one of my favourite books of the Bible. Over the last 6 weeks, we've looked at the Waymaker series and we've learnt about God's character, and we've learnt that in the midst of everything that's happening, God is still working. Even if we don't see him or feel him, God is working. And Esther actually reinforces this. In the book of Esther, God is actually not mentioned at all. And still today, there's debate that happens around whether Esther should even be in the Bible, merely because of that fact that we don't see or hear about God. Yet when we read the book of Esther, we can clearly feel the hand of God working, outworking his plans, his way, in his timing. See, God does have a plan for us. He has a plan for you, he has a plan for me, and he has a plan for us as his church. He is building our faith. At the start of this year, God told us that we needed to build. And so he is continuing to build our faith so that every season we might know him more, so that others might be known as well to God, and that we might show his glory to others. So within the Esther story, we see this plot, a plot to actually annihilate all of God's people, the Jews. Yet in the midst of that, God still has a plan to save his nation, to save his people, to save you, and to save me. His will be completed in his way and in his timing. And he will use faith-filled, ordinary people. See, in every season, God is intentionally building. And sometimes it doesn't feel like it. Sometimes in those in-between seasons, we wonder, is God still working? When we're in between jobs or in between relationships or even in between senior pastors. Yet I believe that in this time, God wants to build. So let's not define ourselves as a church without a senior pastor. Let's define ourselves as God's church. Dave Lasky reminded us probably 6 or 7 weeks ago that Jesus is the head of the church. And he wants to use you and me to build his church. You know, I can really relate to the Esther story, and perhaps you can too. She felt like she was in this in-between season. She was born Jewish with the name Hadassah, yet she wasn't living in her hometown anymore. Both parents had died, and she was being raised by her Jewish cousin. Her name was no longer her own. And I'm sure that she wondered, where's God? Is he really working in my life? What purpose or destiny did he have for her? An unknown Jew, living a quiet, unassuming life. But God did have a plan. He had a purpose and a destiny. Personally, I felt like this. I felt like I've been in this in-between season. You know, that season where maybe you're just feeling like you're filling the gaps, you're doing the right thing, you're doing the helpful thing. For me, honestly, sometimes it feels like I'm just going to fill these gaps till the real leader comes along and takes over. But you know what? God had a plan in all of this. And yes, Jesus is the head of the church, but God actually needs people on earth to fulfill his will. And God challenged me to step up and lead his church through this season. And it's not something that I ever thought that I would do. Just like Esther, who never thought that God would use her to save the Jews. Just like Mary, who never thought that God would use her to birth the Saviour of the world. Yet he does. He asks ordinary, everyday people to obey, to respond to his will, to do it his way in his timing. And God used those exact words of Esther to call me to step up and lead for this season, for such a time as this, to continue to build his church. And he is calling each one of us to respond, to do his will, his way, in his timing. He is building you, he is building me, he is building his church. God is our way maker, yes, but God requires our obedience. God required Esther's obedience to save his children. You see, God plans, we obey. And my prayer is, as we engage in this series, that we will take ownership of our part in God's plan with the strength and conviction that Esther does. See, it required a lot from Esther. It required risk and willingness, and it will require the same from each one of us. As with any sermon series that we do on a whole book of the Bible, we're only going to get to the tip of the iceberg. So what God will require of each one of us, if we want to actually learn God's will and God's way, is to read and study it in your life groups, at home, with your friends, with God. So let's take a brief look at the background of this book. This book is a historical narrative. In other words, it's a true story. It's written in the form of a story. It's full of intrigue and intents and evil and malice, love and respect, law and justice. Really, it's a bit of a soapy, and it's no wonder that there's been several movies made about this book of the Bible. It's set in 486 BC in the kingdom of Persia, of which the capital is Susa. Thousands of Jews have now returned back to Jerusalem from Babylon, from captivity, but some have remained. Some have assimilated into the Persian culture. Families, skilled workers, trained court officials are still there. And this is where we find Esther and her cousin Mordecai. In the opening chapter, we are introduced to King Xerxes, a man of great wealth and power. The setting is this amazing banquet. You would have heard Carol read about this banquet, to which he invited military leaders, princes and nobles, all the elite were invited. And within the story of Esther, we're going to see this constant theme of banquets and drinkings. And each time we see it throughout the book, it actually signals the turning point, something new happening within the story. So I encourage you to look out for that. The king uses this time to celebrate, but also to strategize with the elite. In chapter one, we clearly see his vast wealth. He uses the occasion to display his splendor and his majesty. The banquet lasts for 180 days, 6 months, half a year. I don't know if I can even imagine how large I would be after a banquet that goes for that long. But having won over the elite, he then follows up with another two banquets. And within this next banquet, he invites all the people. Nobody is left out from this invite. The women of the royal palace also enjoy a banquet with the queen. And in the first 10 verses, we are struck by the king's generosity, his inclusiveness of all people. Verse 5 actually says, when it was all over, meaning the feast of 180 days, the king gave a banquet for all the people of the from the greatest to the least, who were in the fortress of Susa, and it lasted for 7 days. It is here that we get a glimpse of grace at work. And I wonder if you can see that reflection of God's grace in there, that he too one day will prepare a table before us, a feast that I will imagine will go way longer than 180 days. One that will be more lavish than this one that we've seen, more generous, one that is inclusive in everybody has been invited to, from the greatest to the least. We will see his grace at work, his will to display his splendor and his majesty to us. The way that God does that, God's motive is actually completely different to the motive we see in this story. So this king was actually all about himself. And when we get our motives around the wrong way, when we use what God has given us for our own glory, instead of grace at work, what we will see will be sin at work. We will see that played out. Instead of seeing God's glory, we will see sin begin to enter this story. And so as we continue to look at this story, after the banquets, what we see is that generosity quickly turns to pride. Abundance turns to abuse and anger. Grace shifts to law, and what was right soon turns very wrong. Wisdom is replaced with foolishness, resulting in consequences for many people. The queen is banished. All women have suddenly got this new decree, a law that opens them up to abuse. Within this decree, it was proclaimed that every man should be a ruler of his own home and should be able to say whatever he wants. The consequences for all women was this opening up to abuse. And the consequences for the king was that he lost his wife. See, when we do things our way instead of God's way, our story can shift. And we see a shift of this story as this happens. However, that does not shift God's plan. We still see God at work. We still see his sovereignty at work. And in this place of confusion, we still see God's plan unfolding. God making a way for a young Jewish woman to save his people, his way, in his timing. See, Esther, along with many other young virgins, was taken from the palace. She was separated from the life that she once knew. Yet in the middle of all that, God is still working. He's planning. He's doing things in his time. In this in-between season, God is still working. You see, Esther, for 18 months after she was put in that palace, she was subject to beauty treatments. In that time, she could have become very bitter, taken away from everything she knew. But we don't see her becoming bitter. What we see, although she is beautiful on the outside, we also see that what is inside Esther, the character of Esther, her faith at work, is actually what will propel her into her destiny. And in chapter 2, we begin to see some of these qualities in her. In verse 10, it says that she remained faithful to her heritage, to her cousin. She followed his directions. Verse 15 says that she accepted advice and that she asked for nothing. And I wonder if perhaps she knew that God was doing something here. We don't actually know that, but somehow I think she might have. I think from her heritage that she was a Jew, that she had been raised by Mordecai, that she was actually keeping faithful to God's word. And we know that because of a letter that was written to the Jews when they were in exile. In Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 4 to 7, we read a portion of this letter. And a lot of the commentaries say that most likely this is how Esther was responding. This is how Mordecai was responding. And that letter says this. It says, "This is what the Lord of heaven's armies, the God of Israel, says to all the captives he has exiled to Babylon from Jerusalem. Build homes and plan to stay. Plant gardens and eat the food they produce. Marry and have children. Then find spouses for them so that you may have many grandchildren. Multiply. Do not dwindle away. Do not lose your focus," God is saying. "Stay focused on me through all of this and work for the peace and prosperity of the city that I have sent you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, for its welfare will determine your welfare." And I wonder if that's what Esther was doing. She knew that if she continued to put the city first, which meant put the king first, then that would determine her welfare. That would determine her destiny. Perhaps this is what Esther was doing. Perhaps she was trusting in God's plan, God's way, even though it's not mentioned. Perhaps in the midst of all this, she could still see God at work. And as we finish off chapter 2, we see Mordecai is also remaining faithful to these promises of God. In Mordecai's life, we see that he now finds himself in the right place at the right time to do God's will. He overhears a plot to kill the king, and he has a choice. Will he obey God's word? Will he trust in God's plan? Or will he allow the king to get what he probably deserved? Mordecai chooses God's way. Mordecai chooses God's plan. He shows reverent obedience to that letter that God had sent through Jeremiah. Trusting in God's plan for him, trusting those plans would prosper him and not harm him, which is another part of that same letter that most of us will know out of Jeremiah 29:11. See, we each have a choice. We have a choice to choose God's plan or our plan. We have a choice to choose God's way or our way, His will or our will, His timing or our timing. And so my question this morning, in this season, what is it that God might be requiring of you? You see, to build, you actually have a plan. But to just have a plan is not going to build. See, God plans, but he uses his people to build. Each one of us have a part to play in his story. Each one of us has a part to play in history, just like Esther did, just like Mordecai did. And that won't be achieved if we sit on the sidelines and watch that story. God actually wants us to be a part of his story. He plans, we build. We each have a part to play in building God's church. So let us not waste this time, this season. Esther waited 18 months in that in-between, and she didn't waste it. She prepared herself. Honestly, I'd like to be prepared the way that Esther did, with beauty treatments and spa baths and all the rest of it. But I think there's this sense that we need to prepare ourselves in this season right now, in what might feel like an in-between season. Whether you've just had a relationship breakdown, don't just dwindle away. If you've lost your job, don't just dwindle away. What are the things that you can do to strengthen yourself? And in this time, as we wait for God's given person to come and lead our church as a senior pastor, let's keep building his church. Let's keep participating in what it is that God wants us to do. Esther prepared herself. How are we preparing ourselves? How are we growing, serving, loving one another? How are we becoming more like Jesus? Let's commit to God's plan, to build our lives of faith, to build his church, following his way, doing it in his timing, each one of us playing our part. Then when it is time for that next chapter, that next season, we will be strong and we will be ready for what God has for us. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you that you plan and that you actually want to have us participating in your story. That you actually want to give us the joy of being part of that, Lord God. Lord, I thank you for your people in the church. I thank you for every person that is working, that is doing your work, whether it is in this building or whether it is out in the community, in their workplaces. Lord, I pray that we will take this challenge as we enter into this Esther series, to prepare ourselves in this season, to grow in our faith, to be faithful to what you have called each one of us to do, Lord God. Lord, I pray and trust that you are preparing a person for your church. And I pray and trust also that you are preparing your church for that person, Lord. So I pray that you'll continue to do that. You will lead us, you will guide us, you will challenge us, and you will use us, Lord. And we pray all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
You put your love on the line to bear the weight of sin that was mine, washing my river. Into the sea of your infinite love, with arms held high, Lord, I give my life, knowing I'm found in Christ, in your love.
Sing forever with us.
knowing I've found in Christ, in your love forever, with all I am, in your grace I stand, the greatest of
welcome to another church update. It's been great to be able to do these updates so we can actually keep you up to date with what's been happening behind the scenes. And prayer is one of those things that has been happening continuously throughout this time of COVID-19. So I thought it would be great to have a conversation with Carol. So welcome, Carol.
Thank you.
For those of you that may not have met Carol, Carol has been doing the prayer ministry at this church for quite a while, and we thought it would be good for you to understand what that looks like. So Carol, mm-hmm. I would really like to know, what does prayer mean to you?
It's a big question. I guess I see prayer as the most vital thing, prayer and scripture, in a person's life. It's the way you communicate with God. It's the way you build relationship with him. We can have a relationship with the creator of the universe, and I find that just astounding. It and is. He actually wants to hear from us, and we can listen to him too during that time and come into his presence. That's what I see prayer does for us.
So why did you get involved in prayer ministry?
I see prayer as a love language. When I pray for people, people say, well, what can you do for someone? And that's the thing that I do. I will pray with people as a way of showing that they're cared for. But not only that, it brings, as I said, the creator of the universe into their circumstance and situation, and we're handing it to him and saying, Lord, we can't do this, but we know you can, and sort of leaving him to empower us to do the things that we need
to. That's a really great reason. How can people be involved in prayer at church? Okay.
Well, number one, you can have your own prayer life. I think that is one of the most vital things, is build your own relationship. And prayer can look different for different people. Some people sing prayers, some people it's poetry, some people it's reading scriptures. People pray in a number of different ways, read the names of God. There's a whole range of ways that you can pray personally. There is monthly prayer in the bulletin. There will be prayers for this community, this church, our country, and also worldwide. There are prayers needed all over the place, and you can be empowered to pray for that. Before every Sunday morning service in the little meeting room, we actually pray every week, so feel free to come and join us. We'd love to see you there. Within the service, of course, people pray within the service. There's always prayer, usually the anchor or someone else. There's a time of connecting, not only through song but also through prayer. Our resonate nights, we've had lovely times of prayer with people, and it'd be good to get back to all those things when we're able to. Definitely. We're looking forward to that. And hopefully within your life groups and DNA groups, you are praying for each other. It's vital that you not just talk to each other, but you also pray for each other in those groups. Monday afternoons, a little group of ladies that all get together and pray. They're from the prayer team, and they've been doing it for many years. And it's lovely. All the prayer points are brought before God at that time.
So there's quite a really active prayer happening within our church, which is really exciting. And from a leadership perspective, it's happening all the time. You know, every staff meeting where we gather weekly, we are praying for those needs of the church, as well as the people that we're aware might be struggling, because each one of the pastoral staff are also involved on the prayer team. So we're very aware of that, and we're praying for people as well. The church council, every time they gather, they monthly pray for all the people. They are also involved in the prayer ministry side of it, so aware of the struggles of people and are praying for them as well. And then you've also got the other prayer teams, the other leadership groups that are praying as well. Every time we meet one-on-one with our leaders, we pray for one another. And that is a real priority in our church, because Jesus makes it a priority. We continue to make it a priority. Mm-hmm. So we've talked a little bit, touched on what this prayer team is. Mm-hmm. Can you explain how somebody might want to get involved in that or what it looks like?
Sure. Currently we use text, or mainly we're hopefully going to move to using email to contact the team of people. As soon as I get a prayer request through, I do the communication to get the wording right, because sometimes I can get quite a lengthy prayer. So I will negotiate sometimes with the wording of that. Also, to see that permissions have been given, if they're for other people, because there's nothing worse than finding out so a prayer has been put out and you didn't know anything about it. So it's all those sort of things, trying to keep it safe for the people. And then that goes to the team, and I've asked them to pray straight away as soon as they get that request, mm-hmm. and they pray for a period of time. If we can get an update, particularly if someone's ill, we try to get those out to people so they're aware of prayers being answered too. Mm. And I think that's really encouraging when you get a prayer and you say, look, the answer's been given. So yeah. So people can see me personally. They can do it through the prayer at sydenhambaptist.com.au. There is an email for that, yep. so they can do it that way. From there, I will speak with people individually, because it is quite an individual thing. It's people who have a heart for prayer, have a heart for other people, and more than that, are so willing to keep it all confidential, because there is an agreement they have to sign, a confidentiality agreement, because we want to keep it safe for people to give their often quite private prayers. Yeah. There are some different levels of prayer that yep. happen. There is quite confidential, which is just myself and one other person yep. Who get those prayers. No one else on the rest of the team know about them. And because people just want the prayer, but they just don't want it to go out to everyone. There are quite a few we get like that. Mm-hmm. And then we have a prayer team of about 26, 27 people.
Yep.
And they are the ones that pray as soon as they get the request.
Yep.
So people can see me or email.
Yep. It sounds like quite a process.
It is.
So
it is.
If somebody mm-hmm. was to email you, mm-hmm. that can be done through the website.
Mm-hmm.
We're trying to shift the website a bit so okay. that it makes it clearer, so that all you need to do is fill in the fields that basically say this is the type of prayer that you want. Mm-hmm. We're going to put a document up on the website for you guys as well, so mm-hmm. that you're aware of what that looks like, because like mm-hmm. Carol said, there's some confidentiality mm-hmm. issues, there's some safety issues. That is part of that is legal stuff, part of that is us just basically wanting to be a safe church mm-hmm. and care for people and make sure that we're doing this mm-hmm. the appropriate way. Mm-hmm. So if somebody wanted to actually join your prayer team,
mm-hmm.
what would that process look like?
Well, they would come and see me or yep. email, and I'll make a time to touch base with yep. them. They have to physically sign the agreement, of yep. course, and I do explain what the agreement's about.
Yep.
Some people just aren't suited to it, mm. and I will be honest and say that, look, because I will pray about that person and ask God's opinion too, because he knows people better than I do. So
yep.
so it's quite, it's an honour to be on that team.
Mm.
It's mature people, and they don't have to be mature in age, but mature people who just have that heart. They love to pray,
yes.
and they love to pray for mm. others.
And yes. it is one of those gifts, you know. Intercession is
yeah.
different to us just praying to God. This mm. is something that God has laid on these people's mm. heart to do,
yeah.
and it's great to see people using their gifts
mm.
in that way. Mm. That's you know, that's really exciting
mm.
that we can
oh, yeah.
we can actually create that space for people to be praying in so many different ways. So mm. this morning you've heard of all those different mm. ways that we can be praying for one another, that we can be praying for our community.
Mm.
It is something that is very important. If you want further information, like I said, head to the website, give it a couple of weeks, probably, given that I'm going on leave for a little bit. And then if you've got any further questions, feel free to mm. contact Carol and ask her.
Mm.
We would love to have you involved mm. if that's what you feel like God is laying on your heart. Mm. Yeah, so thanks, Carol.
Yeah. I was just going to say, for a prayer request, if people have requests, use the email. That's on the website. So send a request through and then I may negotiate and we'll send it through to the team.
And I think that's important when we are back in church. Carol can quite often get five different people asking her for a request. She may forget or she may get the wording wrong. So it's really good if you can
get it right.
Send the wording through so that we can make that happen. What I'd love to do, Carol, is pray for you because you are always praying for everybody else. So I think it would be lovely for us to pray for you, to thank God for you for all you're doing.
Thanks, Joanne.
Lord God, we thank you so much for Carol. We thank you for her willingness to step into this ministry, for her heart that loves people and loves you and wants to be able to intercede for them and see their lives bearing fruit and see them healed and set free, Lord God. So we thank you so much for her. We thank you for every member of the team. Lord God, we pray that you'll continue to bless them and that you will grow that team abundantly. And we pray all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for joining us. We'd love to see you next week. Make sure you jump on board and see us then. Mm-hmm.